This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. When bad things happen to privileged people. Race, gender, and what makes a crisis in America. Written by Dara Z. Strolovitch. Published by the University of Chicago Press. For my grandparents, Harry and Esther, who made it possible. Author's note. Please note that any references to tables or figures that appear in this audiobook version refer to the tables and figures found in the print and ebook editions. Introduction. Crisis politics. Soon after Barack Obama won the 2008 presidential election, and in the depths of what was at that time the most severe economic downturn since the Great Depression, his then chief of staff, Rahm Emanuel, told a group of CEOs, "You never want a serious crisis to go to waste. Things that we had postponed for too long, that were long-term, are now immediate and must be dealt with. This crisis provides the opportunity for us to do things that you could not do before." Emanuel's remarks received what seemed like endless media play, much of which focused on what many observers regarded as its pithy encapsulation of his opportunistic Machiavellian, take-no-prisoners style of politics. But his comments were equally striking for what they implied about the political significance of, and about the political work done by, crisis. First, Emanuel's statement reflected the zeitgeist of that first decade of the 21st century, a moment at which American politics, economics, and culture seemed increasingly and indelibly marked by an ever-expanding array of calamitous events and phenomena, from Hurricane Katrina to the BP oil spill to health pandemics such as H1N1 flu to the attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon to the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan to the economic and financial meltdowns of the Great Recession. Similarly, his suggestion that such phenomena presented opportunities to do things that you could not do before reflected the widely held idea that crises are particularly generative moments for political and policy change. Many observers have noted, for example, that the exceptional circumstances of the Great Depression of the first half of the 20th century had created the opportunities for state intervention that made possible the redistributive and regulatory programs of the New Deal. At the same time, however, Emanuel's remark that crises bring long-term problems to the fore also highlights something more subtle about the political implications of crisis. It reminds us that many of the issues brought into relief by phenomena such as wars, recessions, and health pandemics are not new problems, unanticipated upheavals, discrete incidents, or isolated ruptures. Rather, they are often new or particular manifestations of long-standing problems and conditions that have come to be understood as serious crises, often because they have become newly salient to new, and as I will show, often dominant and relatively privileged populations. Among the circumstances that characterize the period during which Emanuel made this statement, for example, were high rates of unemployment and sharply rising rates of home foreclosures. Neither of these conditions was truly new, however. Instead, both issues had long confronted low-income people, people of color, and women of all races, particularly women who were sole borrowers. Foreclosure rates had been higher, in fact, among African Americans, indigenous people, Latinos, and women who were sole borrowers during what was widely regarded as the housing boom of the mid-1990s than they would be among white borrowers and male breadwinner-headed households during what would come to be labeled a foreclosure crisis a decade later. Similarly, rates of unemployment among women and within Black, indigenous, and Latino communities had been as high during the economically booming 1990s as they would be among white men during the Great Recession of the early 21st century. But although high rates of unemployment and foreclosure had long affected members of these and other marginalized and minoritized groups, dominant political actors and institutions had rarely used the language of crisis to characterize these problems during the previous decades, nor had they typically treated them as exceptional circumstances that created opportunities for state intervention or the chance to do things that you could not do before. Considering Emmanuel's quip in this light reminds us that it is not inevitable that a bad thing will be defined and treated as bad, much less that it will be widely regarded as a policy problem or as an exceptional crisis worthy of and remediable through state intervention and resources. That is, his assertion alerts us to the fact that neither the recognition nor the generativity of a crisis is foreordained. More specifically, it reminds us about what Leah Bassel and Akugo Emejulu call the banality of everyday inequalities, and that the persistent difficulties that affect marginalized, oppressed, and subjugated groups are more typically normalized by dominant political actors than they are labeled and treated as crises. In this context, Emmanuel's words raise questions about the selective application of the language of crisis and about the relationships among this selectivity, the likelihood that a problem will stimulate state action, and the reproduction of hierarchies, subjugation, and oppression. This context also calls into question the causal direction implied by his assertion that crises are things that we had postponed for too long, that were long-term, but that have become immediate and must be dealt with. In particular, it suggests that rather than reflecting the severity or urgency of a problem, as he claims, the act of pronouncing that a problem is a crisis is part of what creates the twin perceptions that it is, in fact, severe and urgent, as well as the optimistic idea that it therefore should and, importantly, can be dealt with. As I will show, increased urgency is not necessarily what makes political actors treat a problem as a crisis. Instead, whether or not a bad thing comes to be labeled and treated as a crisis is often itself a political outcome, the result of problem definition and agenda-setting processes that make it one as political actors organize it into politics and transform it from an ongoing, taken-for-granted and naturalized condition into an intervention and resource-worthy policy problem. Emmanuel's formulation thus makes visible the backdrop of persistent problems, what Bassel and Emejulu call routinized crises, that do go to waste. It also invites us to examine crisis as a major force in the politics of marginalization, first by considering the use of that term to describe some bad things alongside its absence as designator for others, and second, to assess the rhetorical, political, and distributional conditions for and implications of these variations in its application. Most centrally, it invites us to interrogate the selective application of crisis as well as the implications of that selectivity for the justification of state intervention and material resources and for the ways in which these elements work together to distort, mask, and mystify the political and ideological work that crisis does. In other words, it invites us to denaturalize and analyze the effects of what is arguably one of the most naturalized forms of politics today, the politics of crisis. This book takes up these invitations by attempting to conceptualize, operationalize, and assess the implications of crisis politics, the term I use to refer to the processes that structure the relationship between episodic hard times and the kinds of ongoing and quotidian hard times that routinely affect and structure the lived experiences of marginalized groups. Such an analysis, I argue, is critical to making sense of a historical moment at which the seemingly constant invocation of crisis can seem to render that word both profoundly consequential as well as vacuous and hollow. In a political context in which labeling bad things as crises can seem both ubiquitous and so unevenly distributed, are marginalized groups always and inevitably the victims of crisis? Or can crises throw the status quo into disequilibrium in ways that open opportunities for these groups to improve their lived conditions? Faced with calamities that may detract attention from ongoing inequities, at the same time as they subject the general population to the kinds of bad things that marginalized groups face quite regularly, can advocates and movements harness crisis politics to advance long-standing goals? What, in other words, are the political implications of hard times for groups for whom times are, in different ways and to varying degrees, always hard? I answer these questions by systematically exploring the political construction, deployment, and consequences of crisis politics, a concept that encompasses both those bad things that come to be treated as crises by dominant political actors as well as those that are not afforded this treatment, which I call non-crises. Whereas I define crises as bad things that are framed and treated as critical junctures deemed worthy of and remediable through government intervention and resources, I define non-crises as similar or analogous, bad things that instead are treated as natural, inevitable, immune to, and therefore as not warranting state intervention. Stated most boldly, I argue that understanding crisis politics is key to understanding the political landscape of the early 21st century. The twinned lenses of crisis and non-crisis, I argue further, are particularly generative ones through which to understand the persistence and perpetuation of processes that disenfranchise, disempower, and immiserate members of marginalized, oppressed, and subjugated groups, the kinds of endemics and processes of slow violence that, as Ruth Wilson Gilmore argues with regard to racism, produce and exploit group-differentiated vulnerability to premature death. Engaging insights about the social construction of disaster and arguments about the discursive power of political language for problem definition and agenda setting, I bring the vast body of scholarship that treats crises such as wars, disasters, and recessions as drivers of political and policy change into conversation with work by scholars such as anthropologist Janet Reutemann, who argue that crisis is not a condition to be observed, but rather an observation that produces meaning. Considered alongside the work of scholars like Gilmore, who have offered lenses through which to understand the less spectacular but enduring conditions that structure the lives of marginalized groups, I show that whether or not something is treated as a crisis is itself a political outcome that must be explained, and one that produces its own empirical realities and lived conditions. If crisis is ubiquitous, is crisis meaningless? In a 2014 review of three books about crisis narratives, political theorist Sasha Engel writes that numerous recent events have either been identified as crises when they unfolded or are retroactively identified as crises. One might be tempted, he continues, quoting Michel Serre's 2014 book, Times of Crisis, What the Financial Crisis Revealed and How to Reinvent Our Lives and Future, to consider all these at once and to diagnose that the first decades of the 21st century have seen the radical transformation of our relations to the world and nature, culminating in a global crisis. In this environment of seemingly pervasive rhetorical invocations of crisis, one might be forgiven for wondering whether crisis is a concept in urgent need of scrutiny, whether it has become so deeply naturalized that it evades critique, or whether it has become so overdetermined as to prohibit analysis. Historian Reinhard Koselleck, for example, indicts the media for their profligate use of the term, employing it, he argues, interchangeably with unrest, conflict, revolution, and to describe vaguely disturbing moods or situations. The concept of crisis, he contends, which once had the power to pose unavoidable, harsh, and non-negotiable alternatives, has been transformed to fit the uncertainties of whatever might be favored at a given moment. Legal scholar Peter Schuck argues similarly that terms like crisis and catastrophe have come to be used so casually and promiscuously that their meanings have lost whatever precision they may have once possessed, and have acquired that familiar fuzziness that marks so much of our popular discourse. Crisis in Afghanistan, crisis in Darfur, crisis in Iran, crisis in Iraq, crisis in the Congo, crisis in Cairo, crisis in the Middle East, crisis in Main Street, writes Reutemann. Crisis, she argues, has become an omnipresent sign in almost all forms of narrative today, mobilized as the defining category of our contemporary situation and the most common and most pervasive qualifier of contemporary historical conditions. Surveying the bibliography in the social sciences and popular press of the preceding decade, Reutemann concludes that crisis texts are a veritable industry. Although invocations of crisis and their deployment to explain or justify political action might seem to have increased at an alarming pace over the last few decades, neither they nor concerns about their overuse are new, nor are they unique to the early 21st century. Randolph Starne declared in the opening sentences of his 1971 article, Historians and Crisis, for example, that this is an age of crisis seems the least controversial of statements. Old enemies, theology and science, right and left, swear by it, all the evidence is said to prove it. French sociologist Edgar Morin lamented in his provocatively titled 1976 essay, Pour une Christologie, that the notion of crisis had spread in the 20th century to every horizon of contemporary consciousness, leaving no area or issue that is not haunted by the idea of crisis, capitalism, society, the couple, the family, values, youth, science, law, civilization, humanity. And in 1999, 2 years before 9/11, and during a period more commonly recalled as crisis-free, British scholar Colin Hay noted that the concept of crisis is ubiquitous within 18th, 19th, and 20th century social and political thought. Despite, or perhaps because of this pervasiveness, it remains one of the most elusive, imprecise, and generally unspecified concepts within the theoretician's armory. In fact, he concluded, the more one ponders this, the more it seems likely that the term's ubiquity derives precisely from this notorious imprecision. Conceptually fuzzy, imprecise, and over-deployed though the term crisis might be, bad things to which that designation is applied have long been considered defining elements of global and national politics. Frustrated as he was by its ubiquity, for example, Morin argued that crises reveal gaps in our knowledge, as well as in the very social reality where the crisis appears. Austin Surratt and Javier Lazan claim that this revelatory quality offers powerful reminders of the fragility of our social and institutional architectures that lay bare the conditions that make our sense of normalcy possible. Indeed, the idea that crises are turning points and precipitating forces in politics, economics, and society has been central in many domains, including medicine, religion, science, culture, and politics. On the left, the allegedly transformative potential of economic crisis was fundamental, for example, to Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels' early ideas about the ways in which capitalism's contradictions would precipitate socialist revolution. Although, as Bruce Norton explains, Marx himself came to doubt the transformative effects of crises, arguments that capitalist development inevitably produces ever-deepening crisis tendencies have continued to influence Marxist thought. Kevin Rosario notes that David Harvey, Marshall Berman, Edward Sojo, Frederick Jameson, and Michel Foucault are only a few of the many scholars and critics on the left who have grasped the peculiar prominence and resonance of disasters in the world that capitalism has made. On the right, Milton Friedman argued in the preface to the 1982 edition of his 1962 book, Capitalism and Freedom, that only a crisis, actual or perceived, produces real change. As such, crisis remains a potent frame, both as a lens through which to understand events and as a justification for political action. This potency is particularly resonant in the United States, where what are often taken for granted to be crises have long been thought to play significant roles in political and policy change. Journalist Naomi Klein argues, for example, that corporations and political actors exploit the shock of crises to privatize public goods, services, and rights for their own profit, with devastating consequences for low-income people and dire consequences for democracy more generally. Echoing these arguments about what Klein labels the shock doctrine of neoliberal disaster capitalism, Rosario goes as far as to argue that in the United States, crises' close cousin disasters have made history, playing a long and influential role in the construction of American identities, power relations, economic systems, and environmental practices. More recently, Ian Bremmer has highlighted what he argues is the unique power of crises to command policymakers' attention when it comes to issues such as pandemics and climate change. The belief that crises are generative forces in American politics and policy is likewise evident in the scholarship across many disciplines that has addressed important and widely ranging topics and questions about their consequences. How far-reaching are the effects of crises? How do crises affect civic participation, political campaigns, trust in government, and attitudes toward outgroups? How does crisis rhetoric affect policy outcomes? Do crises increase public tolerance for austerity measures, autocratic power, and contractions in civil liberties? How do governments create crises, how well do they manage them, and what do they learn from them? Crisis and marginalized groups. Scholars have also explored and debated the particular implications of crises for marginalized, subjugated, and stigmatized groups such as women, indigenous people, people of color, low-income people, immigrants, and lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer, LGBTQ people in the United States. Many have argued that crises exacerbate pre-existing inequities and detract attention and resources from issues affecting marginalized groups. Others, such as Gwen Prowse, have noted that exogenous shocks have long collided with structural inequalities to produce catastrophes for members of race-class subjugated communities. Almost by definition, for example, low-income people are likely to suffer more acutely than are more affluent people during economic and financial crises. Because of racial and gender disparities in income and wealth, economic crises disproportionately disadvantage Black and Indigenous people, Latinos, and women of all races and ethnicities. At the height of the Great Depression, for example, 25% of American workers were unemployed, but the rate was double that, approaching 50%, among African Americans. Analogous disparities were evident during the Great Recession in the early 21st century. In 2009, rates of unemployment among African Americans in the 15 largest U.S. metropolitan areas were, on average, 7 percentage points higher than rates among whites, with differences as high as 13.8% in Minneapolis-St. Paul, where white unemployment was 6.6% and Black unemployment 20.4%, and 10.6% in Memphis, where white unemployment was 5.1% and Black unemployment 15.7%. More recently, both the health and economic effects of what would come to be called the COVID-19 crisis took a disproportionate toll on marginalized and intersectionally marginalized groups, as Black and Indigenous people, Pacific Islanders, and Latinos experienced exponentially higher rates of infection and mortality. Members of these same groups also faced higher rates of unemployment, as did women, who were also overrepresented in occupations that faced increased exposure to the virus. This multi-edged and gendered disaster was particularly pronounced among Black women and Latinas, who are disproportionately employed in sectors that were especially hard hit by the pandemic shutdowns, such as retail, hotels, restaurants, and education, as well as in sectors that left them exposed to the virus, such as healthcare. Women also bore the brunt of the care-related challenges exacerbated by the pandemic, including those related to school closures and to the rapid spread of the virus in elder care facilities, a situation that led many to try to care for their elderly parents at home. A related body of work has emphasized the crisis-borne political constraints, challenges, and setbacks for groups and movements struggling to achieve social, economic, and political change. Jeffrey Berry argues, for example, that events like wars and depressions often lead advocacy groups to prioritize issues like basic economic and physical security, pulling back from their work on what he calls post-material issues like civil rights. Calls for national unity during the Civil and First World Wars led to attacks on women's suffrage organizations as unpatriotic, for example, and unions have been similarly attacked for threatening to strike during wars and in the wake of 9/11. Similarly, a large body of scholarship documents the many ways in which so-called states of exception accompanying wars, natural disasters, economic shocks, and health pandemics have long led to increased public tolerance for and have long been used to justify economic austerity and other neoliberal reforms, the consolidation of executive and often autocratic power, and contractions in civil liberties, particularly for marginalized and minoritized groups. Kyle White argues, for example, that people who perpetrate colonialism often imagine that their wrongful actions are defensible because they are responding to some crisis. This crisis epistemology, he argues further, assumes that to respond to a crisis, it is possible to suspend certain concerns about justice and morality, with devastating impacts on indigenous peoples across ancestral, living, and emerging generations. In an interview with journalist David Sanger, historian Robert Caro went as far as to argue that a central lesson of the effects of the Vietnam War on the Johnson administration's ability to achieve its goals was that wars kill movements for domestic reform. And while much of this work takes as given that bad things labeled crises indeed warrant this designation, scholars also show that political institutions and elites create crises, often ones from which they ultimately benefit either politically or materially, and often at the expense of members of marginalized groups. White explains, for example, that in the first half of the 20th century, the American government flooded the lands of Seneca and Lakota peoples to create dams, actions it justified with the assertion that the United States needed energy and irrigation to lessen the perceived threat of the Soviet Union in the Cold War. Stuart Hall and his colleagues argue that constructing crime as a mugging crisis in the 1970s allowed British elites to shift public attention and blame away from their repressive assaults on and declining conditions of working people and onto Black and Asian people. As sociologist David Pello summarizes Hall's argument, some of the very institutions that helped produce and construct this crisis benefited from it. More generally, he argues, one person's catastrophe is another person's day at the beach, and a crisis for one group can be an opportunity for another. Modern market economies are supposed to produce social inequalities and environmental inequalities, Pello continues. Is this a crisis? That depends on whom you ask. This last point reminds us that crises can cut in multiple directions, and scholars and political observers note that elites may not be their sole beneficiaries. Thomas Birkeland and others argue, for example, that focusing events such as wars and economic crises can have silver linings for marginalized groups, what philosopher Thomas Homer Dixon calls the upside of down. On this view, while material conditions might worsen, crises can also open what John Kingdon calls policy windows, broadening the scope of the conflict and improving conditions within what social movement scholars label the political opportunity structure by giving advocates and activists opportunities to push for changes that address the ongoing bad things that affect their constituents. A large body of scholarship presents evidence, for example, that rights and resources for groups including women, low-income people, and people of color have advanced significantly during times of or as a consequence of wars and other crises. Both the welfare state and labor rights expanded dramatically in the context of the Great Depression, and scholars have argued that the same has been true of civil rights during the Revolutionary War, Civil War, the First and Second World Wars, and the Cold War. Scholars attribute the creation of mothers' pensions to the Civil War, for example, and while the wartime patriotism of women's suffrage activists was attacked, some argue that the participation of women in that war and World War I ultimately eased the way for women's suffrage as well. Others have argued that war can stimulate civic engagement, that public sympathy for the poor often increases during hard economic times, and that this sympathy, in turn, can open the door not only for redistributive policies that proved elusive in more prosperous times, but also, perhaps, for the kinds of utopian possibilities that Rebecca Solnit characterizes as a paradise built in hell. More recently, scholars have documented the ways in which the devastation of the HIV/AIDS crisis served as an important mobilizer for LGBTQ people and movements. From this perspective, even if members of a marginalized group suffer materially and disproportionately as a consequence of a recession, a disaster, or a pandemic, the movements and organizations that advocate on their behalf might benefit from crises through increased visibility, sympathy, media attention, or donations. So powerful is the sense that crises are important engines of progressive change in the United States, Michelle Dauber argues, that the origins and expansion of the American welfare state were based not in the claims to citizenship that were central to the development of its European counterparts, but instead on precedents drawn from the previous 150 years of federal disaster relief. Relief intended not to alleviate long-standing conditions of poverty, but to provide temporary aid to deserving victims of events understood to be outside of their control. I have come to wonder, Rosario writes, whether dominant American ideas of progress would even be imaginable without disasters. In light of both the seeming causal centrality, but also the conceptual ambiguity of crisis in ideas about political and policy change, and in the midst of what can appear to be a never-ending onslaught of catastrophes, emergencies, and disasters, there is renewed urgency to interrogate and track the political construction, meanings, deployment, and effects of crisis, to, as Moran implores, put the concept of crisis in crisis. Conceptualizing crisis politics as an object of study. This book attempts to heed that plea. My approach to doing so draws on and is indebted to the insights and interventions of the foregoing important bodies of work, but I ask a somewhat different set of questions about the ways in which crises and ideas about crises are implicated in American politics and public policy. First, much of the work in the vast bodies of scholarship in history, political science, and public policy that examine phenomena such as wars, natural disasters, and recessions treats these crises as independent variables that drive agenda setting and of political and policy change. In contrast, drawing on ideas from the sociology of disaster and critical disaster studies, and on the arguments of scholars who underscore the constructed nature of disasters and crises more generally, I emphasize the development, deployment, and consequences of crisis as a political term, concept, and construct. That is, I treat the definition of crisis as endogenous to politics, as a dependent variable that needs to be explained, rather than an independent variable that, as Leslie McCall writes, should be doing the explaining. Second, while my approach entails examining crisis politics at a general level, my central and more proximate aim is to adjudicate some of the tensions and competing claims about their implications for marginalized groups. These tensions and claims are thrown into relief by putting constructivist understandings of crises into conversation with work that treats crises as independent variables in the ways I began to do above. On the one hand, the bad things that shape the everyday lived experiences of marginalized groups are not considered crises unless and until they affect dominant groups. On the other hand, however, once a crisis is hailed into being, it can have real and far-reaching political and material reverberations, both for the lived conditions of marginalized groups as well as for the possibility of opening windows of opportunity to address long-standing inequities. To these ends, the book is animated by and structured around three central empirical questions about crisis politics. First, how did crisis enter and come to so structure, even dominate, American political and policy discourse and processes? Second, are some bad things more likely than others to be constructed as crises, and if so, what are the political processes through which this happens? Finally, once a bad thing has been constituted as a crisis, what are the implications of such constructions for the political opportunities facing marginalized groups, particularly for those whose marginality is constituted by the intersections of multiple axes of inequality, including race, class, gender, and sexuality? These questions contain both an ontological facet, what is a crisis, and an epistemological one, how do we political actors, the state, know what a crisis is? Through my analyses, I show that when it comes to crisis politics, these two facets are inextricably bound up with one another. In particular, through inductive examinations of a wide array of evidence, I begin by showing empirically that crisis neither is a neutral descriptor of empirically bad things, nor has it been a constant in mainstream political discourse. Instead, crisis politics have a genesis and a distinct historical trajectory, and both their origins and their arc have significant implications for the politics of marginalization and marginalized groups. We might assume, for example, that bad things are more prone to being labeled crises the more people they affect, the more they rupture with the past, and the more amenable they are to government intervention, but this is not the case. Instead, I show that crisis is endogenous to and recursive within politics. That is, I show that crisis politics are not only productive of, but also the products of political battles and decisions, and that having a bad thing societalized and recognized as a crisis within dominant institutions is itself a political goal and victory that often has very real material and policy consequences, ones that often have feedback effects of their own. As Ian White and Gauri Nandedkar put it, crises are truth claims. They are invoked, they define, and in doing so, they privilege certain ideologies or policy solutions over others in ways that may lead to different policy interventions and different attributions of political responsibility. In other words, it does not suffice to ask whether a particular crisis is real or constructed, as the designation of any bad thing as a crisis is always, to some degree, the product of political contestation. As Hannah Arendt argues, in politics, more than anywhere else, we have no possibility of distinguishing between being and appearance. In the realm of human affairs, being and appearance are indeed one and the same. We all play language games, Murray Edelman explains in his discussion of Arendt. The goal, in his view, is therefore to understand these multiple realities, not to try to determine which position is real or realistic. That is, understanding crisis politics entails stepping back from crisis discourse to recognize and interrogate the contested truths the language of crisis smuggles in under the guise of received wisdom. Is it true, as many of us intuit, that the political use of crisis language has risen dramatically? If so, what are we to make of this increase? How can we understand the subtexts and assumptions that underlie it? And what, if anything, can laying them bare help us to understand about the political work that crisis politics make possible or that they frustrate? My analyses shed some light on these issues by mapping the changing political meanings of the word crisis, reconstructing the key historical shifts in its political uses, and exploring the implications of these meanings and uses for structuring the politics of power and marginalization. Studying crisis politics empirically. To operationalize and examine crisis politics empirically, the research for this book combines inductive and deductive approaches and draws on evidence from a range of sources, including content analyses of textual and archival evidence from print media, party platforms, congressional bills and hearings, presidential addresses, and advocacy organizations' publications and congressional testimony. Analyzed in light of insights based in theories of intersectionality, critical disaster studies, and the large body of theoretical and empirical work about crisis and related concepts, such as disaster, catastrophe, and states of emergency, this evidence allows for the first examination of the genesis and evolution of American crisis politics and of their implications for the politics of marginalization and injustice in the United States. Crisis as a political keyword. I begin with a very literal approach to identifying when and the processes through which crisis politics are constructed and are at work. In particular, I propose that we can start to appreciate their significance and their relationship to the politics of marginalization and oppression by analyzing the evolution of crisis as a political keyword. Here I borrow from British cultural theorist and materialist critic Raymond Williams, who uses the concept of keywords to capture a phenomenon that he encountered when returning home after serving in the Second World War. As he describes it, the meanings of words like culture had multiplied and shifted while he was away, forcing themselves on his attention because the problems of their meaning were inextricably bound up with the problems they were being used to discuss. Although cultural theorists originated the keyword approach, scholars across many disciplines have adopted it to explore the constitutive role of language and discourse in politics, and to understand the ways in which the terms that are used to describe social life are also active forces shaping it. Daniel Rogers uses a keyword approach, for example, to examine the role of words like rights, freedom, and interests in American political history and development. Nancy Fraser and Linda Gordon examine dependency as a keyword, while Stuart Hall and his co-authors analyze the cultural and political work of the term mugging. Patricia Strack, draws on this method to examine the use of family in politics and policy, and Sarah Churchwell takes a similar approach in examining the origins, history, and significance of the phrases American Dream and America First. Given its centrality in contemporary American political discourse, it is hard to think of a keyword more ripe for such an analysis than crisis. I bring these ideas into conversation with the insights of scholars such as Stuart Hall, Murray Edelman, Deborah Stone, Joseph Gusfield, Ange Marie Hancock, and George Lakoff, who argue that language shapes politics and material conditions by constructing beliefs about political causes and effects. To do so, I begin to chart the development and evolution of crisis politics by exploiting the availability of digitized sources, including newspapers, government publications, and political documents, to track the actual use of the word crisis in political discourse and to compare its use on the part of dominant actors with the ways in which is it used by representatives of and political actors from marginalized communities. Using this blunt, but, as I hope readers will agree, powerfully illuminating instrument, I follow the lead of scholars who denaturalize crisis by treating it as a political construct rather than as an empirical reality. That is, I show that crisis has no inherent political meaning, but instead has achieved its significance through social and political processes. More specifically, the term itself entered the English lexicon as a medical term used to describe the turning point for better or worse in an acute disease, according to Merriam-Webster's dictionary. I show that when it first traveled from its scientific origins to politics, it described a relatively narrow set of political and economic turning points, most of which had to do with wars, recessions, and conflicts in or with other countries. I show further that its expanded application to domestic phenomena in the U.S. context seems to have originated among abolitionists and racial justice advocates in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. They repurposed it as part of an effort to change the way in which ongoing and endemic racial oppression was understood, not as an inevitable and eternal fact of nature, but rather as an urgent issue facing a critical juncture, one at which concerted state intervention was necessary, justified, and would make a decisive and desirable difference. In the 1960s, dominant political actors took up this meaning as well. But whereas civil rights leaders had pioneered the use of crisis in an effort to justify state intervention and resources to address the ongoing struggles of marginalized, oppressed, and subjugated groups, dominant political actors were far more likely to use it to signal that the status quo was under threat, and to argue either that state intervention was necessary to address bad things affecting privileged people or to advance neoliberal agendas of state retrenchment. As crisis made this journey from medicine to politics and economics, and then to social life, its use as a political term increased markedly and took on four broad clusters of different but overlapping and politically revealing meanings. First among these is what I call clear-cut crises, seemingly self-evident shocks and disasters that are understood to be relatively quick, discrete, and episodic. Second, crisis came to be used to designate conditions, that is, political actors came to use the concept of crisis as a turning point, as a way to raise the urgency of long-term domestic problems that had previously been viewed as intractable, shifting the time frame within which we understand them to stimulate and justify political and policy responses. Political actors also try to stimulate crises through confrontations and disruptions, a meaning that I label crisis as creation. Finally, crisis came to be used as a synonym for a very bad thing, a meaning that I label calamity as crisis. Equally significant, however, is that for every bad thing that is constituted as a universalized crisis, myriad others are never so labeled. I show that the constitution of crisis as a way to understand some kinds of bad things therefore also came to constitute its inverse, non-crisis, bad things that are not treated as crises by dominant political actors, but that have analogs that are. The idea of non-crisis builds on and is indebted to concepts that scholars have offered as lenses through which to understand the implications of marginalization and oppression. Like endemics, slow or premature death, routinized crisis, uneventful catastrophe, everyday state of emergency, slow disaster, slow violence, and withheld violence. For example, non-crisis is intended to describe and encompass a range of naturalized, non-spectacular, but enduring conditions such as long-term unemployment, poverty, homelessness, mass incarceration, and racialized and gendered wage disparities and violence that structure the lives and lived experiences of members of marginalized groups. It is also indebted to Rachel Luft's conceptualization of racialized disaster patriarchy, which she describes as the political, institutional, organizational, and cultural practices that converge before, during, and after disaster to produce injustice. And like concepts such as non-issues, suppressed issues, unpolitics, and semantically masked crises that political scientists and policy scholars have developed to describe and understand the political power and powerlessness of these same groups, non-crisis also aims to provide a lens through which to understand the reasons why and mechanisms via which some issues are organized into politics while others are organized out. Non-crisis brings these bodies of ideas into conversation and specifies that what are often assumed to be long-term non-crises often have usually episodic and shorter-term counterparts that are treated as aberrant and temporary crises that must, and as importantly, can be resolved in order to avoid some disastrous or catastrophic outcome. In these ways, the framework of crisis and non-crisis provides analytic purchase on crisis politics, the processes through which long-term and enduring problems that so often are taken for granted as unalterable parts of the normal political and economic landscape, when they are related to naturalized conditions of vulnerability affecting marginalized populations, become departicularized and regarded as universalized and intervention-worthy crises when they affect dominant groups or broader publics. Crisis and non-crisis. Tracing the use, prevalence, and evolving meanings of crisis as a keyword inductively illuminates much about the construction of crisis politics, but reveals only one facet of this process. So, after establishing in Part 1 what crisis politics are, and that the political meanings of crisis have evolved in particular ways in the American context, I move in Part 2 to a more deductive examination of the construction and implications of particular crises and non-crises. The analyses in this part of the book place less emphasis on the presence and absence of the word crisis, and focus instead on examining the processes through which bad times for some groups come to be treated as crises, while the bad times endured by others do not. To do so, I use a set of matched cases through which I explore the particular framings of one bad thing that became defined as a crisis, comparing it alongside an analogous bad thing that was treated as a non-crisis. Specifically, I compare the ways in which economic reporters and dominant political actors addressed subprime mortgages and foreclosures during what came to be widely known as the early 21st century's foreclosure crisis, comparing this attention with that devoted to these issues during what I label the foreclosure non-crisis of the late 1990s. Subprime lending was proliferating, and foreclosure rates were, by some measures, higher among people of color and sole borrower women in the late 1990s than they would be among white and male breadwinner households during what would come to be labeled a crisis a decade later. I show, however, that economic reporters and dominant political actors neither described nor treated these issues as problems worthy of and remediable through federal intervention during this earlier period. Instead, in a context marked by federal policymakers' efforts to replace redistribution with expanded access to credit, they accepted lenders' zombie facts that, in spite of a wealth of evidence to the contrary, women and people of color were risky borrowers who did not qualify for better loan terms. They also treated privatized subprime mortgages, rather than government spending or regulation, as the appropriate state action to increase rates of homeownership among women and people of color, and to resolve distributional problems more generally. In so doing, they naturalized and particularized the extractive and often predatory terms of subprime loans and the attendant high rates of foreclosure among these two groups, all but precluding the possibility of robust state intervention to address them. Even after the crisis was declared, economic reporters and dominant political actors continue to naturalize and particularize these race and gender-related inequalities as non-crises, treating the disproportionately high rates of subprime mortgages and foreclosure among women and people of color as outside of what was understood to be the crisis and beyond the power of the federal government to remedy. Moreover, while the foreclosure crisis elicited a more robust federal response, this intervention came too late to help members of groups who had been losing their homes at high rates in the decade before the crisis was declared. These policy interventions consequently did little to narrow disparities in rates of homeownership or to address inequitable and discriminatory access to mortgage loans. Instead, the kinds of intersecting racial and gender disparities in rates of high-cost mortgages and foreclosures that were evident in the 1990s have persisted. The end of the crisis meant, in other words, a return to normal, pre-crisis conditions of deeply entrenched and intersectionally constituted inequalities and injustice. This is the essence of crisis politics. When bad things happen to privileged people, by exposing some of the ways in which the term crisis has come to do the political work that it does, the keyword analysis and the examinations of the foreclosure crisis and non-crisis reveal some of the processes that fuel both crisis politics and their role in processes that reinforce and perpetuate inequality and marginalization. First, by denaturalizing crisis, the analyses underscore its malleability and constructedness, and remind us that contrary to dominant assumptions, crisis is not a material and self-evident thing, the contours of which we can identify, measure, and distinguish from bad times or bad things that are not crises. Instead, the history of crisis politics underscores that it is conventions about what is normal and about whose pain is tolerable that have come to serve as indicators that we have entered or exited a crisis. The implications of these conventions are far more than rhetorical, because these conventions underlie arguments about when and what kind of state intervention is and is not acceptable, and because they rely on assumptions and practices that reflect, reproduce and reconstitute prevailing attitudes and normative expectations about racialized and gendered inequalities, they also justify policies that preserve and often reinforce the real material effects of both crises and non-crises. Bringing this understanding of crisis politics to bear on the paired analyses of the subprime mortgage crisis and its non-crisis analog helps to understand the ways in which the power and privilege of those perceived to be affected by hard times serve, one, to construct some troubles as normal, and others as aberrant and temporary crises that can and must be resolved. Two, to frame problems related to structural inequalities as natural, inevitable, immune to, and therefore not warranting state intervention. And three, to shape ideas about policy solutions to hard times that are universalized and treated as crises. As such, the cases underscore that the very notions of crisis and recovery are political and ideological constructs, and that conditions of vulnerability, typically naturalized, particularized, and simply taken for granted as part of the normal landscape when they affect marginalized populations, often become universalized as crises worthy of and remediable through state intervention and resources when they affect dominant or relatively privileged groups. This story is not at odds with arguments that crisis language is overdeployed and imprecise, nor does it contradict the scholarship showing that crises intersect with broader political conditions to present a unique mix of constraints and opportunities to raise the salience of long-standing problems and to exploit policy windows to achieve long-standing goals. But the analyses do suggest that although bad things that come to be constructed as crises can present marginalized groups and their advocates with opportunities to achieve.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.